Hi, I'm Michelle Young with USF Health, and we're here today with Associate Professor for MCOM, Dr. Dominic D'Agostino, and he works in pharmacology and
physiology.
Yep. That's right, and you are an expert and work in the ketosis field. So can you give me a little bit, people talk about the keto diet, and we know that we're entering, right now we're in the throes of the eating holidays, and come January 1st, everybody's resolution at the top is going to be lose weight.
Always. Yeah.
And they're going to Google, how do I lose weight?
Yeah.
And they're going to hit keto diet and they're going to say, I keep hearing about that. So let's talk a little bit about that.
I think in 2017, it was the most Google term, Google diet, the ketogenic diet. So the ketogenic diet really has its history, its foundation is actually for epilepsy. So I'm classically trained as a neuroscientist, so that's and we study seizures. So the ketogenic diet got put on my radar because it is the standard of care for drug refractory or drug resistant epilepsy. And we study oxygen toxicity seizures that are an issue with military or special operations forces dieting. So that's how it got put on our radar. It is a medical diet. The classic ketogenic diet is a medical diet that's like 90% fat. The ketogenic diet that you hear in the media, that's on the news, is really much more liberal in protein. So a ketogenic diet is adequate protein to moderate protein, very high fat to moderate to high fat with a more layman's ketogenic diet, and then very low in carbohydrates. And eating that macronutrient ratio, the ratio of fat to protein to carbohydrates, that specific ratio is actually what makes a ketogenic diet ketogenic by virtue of elevating something in your blood or urine called ketone bodies. And these ketone bodies function as alternative energy substrates for the brain. And they also have profound effects on your body, like anti-inflammatory effects. They have epigenetic effects that we're studying in the lab. So the science of the diet has really evolved tremendously in the last 10 years that I've been studying it. And that's very exciting to me as a scientist.
And we're here in a lab right here at MCOM, which is, there's a lot of stuff going on, lots of noises, a lot of stuff going on in this room, a lot of experiments. How exciting for you is it, you've been studying this for so long, and then you said it's the most Googled term this year. So talk a little bit about the evolution of that and how it's become a popular thing for people to use as a way to lose weight.
Yeah, so in 2008, the ketogenic diet primarily had one application. If you Googled it, you came up with the Charlie Foundation. The Charlie Foundation is for pediatric epilepsy, and that was really the only application at the time in 2008. And the Charlie Foundation is run by Hollywood producer Jim Abrams, and his son Charlie had drug-resistant seizures, was put on the diet, and it worked remarkably well. And he was angry, more or less, because it was not offered to him as a treatment option. So his friend, Meryl Streep, made a movie about the ketogenic diet. It was called First Do No Harm. And I believe that movie is free on YouTube, First Do No Harm with Meryl Streep. And that really inspired me to study the diet, the ketogenic diet, for epilepsy and for seizure disorders. So that's how I sort of got on the track. But I think maybe the low-hanging fruit for the masses for the ketogenic diet is its ability to regulate your blood glucose, and by virtue of doing that, it helps to regulate your appetite. Your blood glucose fluctuations throughout the day are virtually abolished or significantly attenuated when you're eating a ketogenic diet, so you don't have cravings for sweets as you normally would with a carbohydrate-based diet. So I believe that the ketogenic diet is effective for fat loss and weight loss for a number of reasons, but primarily because it allows the person to adhere to an eating strategy that makes it easier to have a calorie deficit. By virtue of controlling your appetite and cravings, you're more likely to stick to your diet and not only lose weight, but keep the weight once it's off. A lot of people can lose weight, but they can't sustainably keep that weight off. And I think with a low carb, ketogenic diet eating strategy, I think that becomes an easier thing to do, in my opinion.
So let's talk a little bit about the keto diet. If a regular person's going to do it, what does a meal plan look like when you hear keto? They think, oh, I'm going to eat a whole bunch of protein and eat a bunch of fat. Do you eat breakfast, lunch, dinner, snacks? Is it all based around that? Can we talk a little bit about that?
Sure. So the ketogenic diet is a macronutrient ratio. So your macronutrients are fat, protein, and carbohydrates. And I consider ketones also a macronutrient because it's an energy substrate that is now in supplement form, and we can talk about that later. But there are a variety of things. Actually, I just presented to you a package that arrived to me called Keto Fridge. So these are foods that could be pre-prepared and sent to your door, and they have a variety: bacon-wrapped salmon, shrimp scampi, Cajun chicken pot pie. So these are just some of the foods that are available. There's a number of companies out there that are making the ketogenic diet much more accessible to the non-clinical world. And this makes it easy for people who want to adhere to the ketogenic diet, but they don't necessarily want to or desire to weigh everything out. So all the calculations sort of have been done for you. So I eat these foods and I test these foods as part of the research that we do, but personally, I had breakfast this morning. Every other day I do intermittent fasting, which I don't eat until like early afternoon, and that's another thing we could talk about. But this morning I had...
It's another Facebook Live.
Yeah, I had 4 eggs that were cooked in butter, and I had a muffin, a cheddar cheese muffin, and instead of using wheat flour, almond flour and eggs and butter were used to make the muffin, and it was just a little bit more dense. But that was my breakfast for the morning, and the macronutrients were about 70% fat, maybe about 20% protein, and about 10% fibrous carbohydrates. So that would be an example. I eat a lot of salads, eat a lot of broccoli, green vegetables. You can eat carbohydrates on a ketogenic diet, but they have to be restricted to essentially non-glycemic carbohydrates. Throughout the course of a day, for example, 1 pound of salad, 1 pound of broccoli, a half cup of wild blueberries, all of that I just mentioned is 50 grams of carbohydrates, and half of that is fiber. So think about the ketogenic diet. You could have almost unlimited amounts of green vegetables and salads, and I tend to have a little bit of fruit at night, usually about a third to a half a cup of blueberries and maybe a piece of dark chocolate, and I'm still staying within that 50 grams of carbohydrate range, which are primarily fiber. And if I check my ketone levels during the day, I tend to stay in a low state of ketosis, which I think you get a lot of benefits of the diet, not necessarily being super strict. That would be necessary if you're managing a disorder like epilepsy or a metabolic disease, but to get the energy benefits, the lower inflammation benefits, and the appetite suppressing effects, generally speaking, about 50 grams of carbs or less per day would be needed to follow what I call the layman's version of the ketogenic diet.
Can you meal prep for the keto diet, say Sunday afternoon, cut up your vegetables, prepare your salad? So it's not, it could be intimidating for somebody to hear all those things you just talked about. Wow, that sounds like way too much prep. I don't have time for that. You mentioned the keto fridge is an area you can go to.
Yep.
Sure, you can go into the regular grocery store and look for keto products. But also some of that meal prep. So talk about some of that meal prep and what that would look like. You'd be cutting up celery, carrots, what fruits, vegetables, meat. Well, how can you prepare your meat ahead so that people can be ready for the week?
Yeah, so it does come down to portion sizes and calories too. And I think meal prep is, you know, if you're starting a diet and you fail to plan to prep, you're really planning to fail, I guess, you know, the old adage. What I would do, one strategy would be to, you know, buy foods that are only within the realm of low carb ketogenic meal plans. And there's many books available. I have a stack of books of ketogenic recipe books. And you want to basically, the best thing to do is probably use one of the many apps out there like MyFitnessPal, and then construct the meals from foods that you personally like that fit the macronutrient ranges of the ketogenic diet. Essentially, if you're eating 3 meals a day, you would want the carbohydrate content of the meals to be 15 to no more than 20 grams of carbohydrates, non-sugar, non-starch, so basically fibrous carbohydrates from vegetables. You know, typically 10 to 15 grams, ideally, from things like broccoli, cauliflower, asparagus, green leafy vegetables. You know, I eat a lot of salads. Fatty cuts of meats are okay, chicken with the skin, beef, a lot of fish. So I advocate for a lot of fatty fish. Sardines are a big staple of mine. Eggs, I'll have sardines for breakfast too. Eggs and the egg yolks are like a perfect ketogenic food. I actually often make an egg yolk omelet where I take the whites and give them to my dogs and mix them, and I eat the actual yolks.
So you've talked a little bit about flour and the almond flour, the coconut flour, some of those different flours.
Yeah.
Do you also eat flax seeds, hemp seeds? Where is this with beans, like black beans?
Yeah.
Garbanzo beans, or do you cut down on the beans a little bit?
So beans would be allowed, but you'd really just have to stick to that carbohydrate or macronutrient ratios, the fats, the proteins, the carbs. And a lot of the ketogenic diet cookbooks out there already do the work for you. So they say, you know, here's what you need. So beans would be sort of leaning towards more of a starch. But, you know, when it comes to different types of flours, you could buy hazelnuts and mix it in a food processor and get kind of a dry, fluffy powder, and that works good. Almond flour, coconut flour, hazelnut flour. These are all things that are used by many of the parents who have children with epilepsy, and they could design baked goods like pancakes and muffins and cookies and things like that. So the more comfort foods. So they have their place too, but I'm a big proponent of whole food meals. And I chaired a session at the American Epilepsy Society meeting last week, and an entire session, special interest group session within the AES meeting was implementation of the diet. And that's a very big theme for that. And there's a lot of emerging technologies coming out as far as apps that you could have for your phone, different types of flour, cooking flour. I know Keto Cow is a medical shake, but you can also use that powder for in place of wheat flour and things like that. So there are a lot of options that if people just do a Google search, they'll find a lot of substitutes. So you can actually continue to have your own foods, but you substitute out the ingredients for different things. And
you said MyFitnessPal was a great place to get started.
MyFitnessPal is really good. Chronometer is another one. And many of these platforms are free. And as you track it, you can basically measure your ketones in your urine or your blood ketones with a ketone meter. The Abbott Precision Extra or the Keto Mojo is a pretty good meter for measuring your ketones. And then you can assess your blood glucose and ketone response to the meals. And you know, everybody is a unique metabolic entity, and their response to a particular meal might be different. So you have to do a lot of personal sort of experimenting, even with the types of meals and types of foods too that agree with you. So, well, one way to approach it too, there's a lot of low carb meals out there. If you design a low carb eating plan and add fat to that, that makes the meal more ketogenic. Keeping your carbohydrates under 15 grams per meal, ideally less than 50 grams per day of fibrous carbohydrates, and keeping protein moderate, not high, because protein can kick you out of ketosis, and then creating a low-carb meal plan and then adding additional healthy fats to that. And that could be from olive oil, nut butters, you know, butter ghee, things like that are things that we use.
Ghee, that's one that I've seen in the grocery store.
Yeah, it's pretty good, actually.
So in your research, you were in the process of developing some ketone supplements. Can you tell us a little bit more about that? Is that like a vitamin, or what that is, or what's in it? Research is telling you?
So I talked about the macronutrients, fat, protein, and carbohydrates. We consider ketones as a fourth macronutrient, and they are an energy-containing molecule that can be put into a powder or a liquid form and consumed orally to induce a state of therapeutic ketosis. And that therapeutic ketosis can, from our perspective, be a very powerful anti-seizure, anti-convulsant strategy. It could be used to enhance brain energy metabolism. It could be used as an adjunct to the ketogenic diet to further enhance the therapeutic efficacy of the diet to alter it in that way. And now they've come to the point where the ketone salts or various ketogenic supplements on the market actually taste good. So you could use these supplements as a powder. Ketogenics makes them, prove it. They sell ketogenic. There's a number of ketogenic supplements on the market. Our website, ketonutrition.org, lists the ones that we have tested. And these can be consumed more or less like an energy supplement. Years ago, there was a supplement.
Consume them like a snack?
You can. So you can drink them. They taste good. They taste like a fruity drink. And they could be used throughout the duration of the day if you need energy. Some of them have caffeine in them, about as much as a cup of coffee. So if you need a midday boost instead of coffee, you could be delivering an energy substrate, the ketone bodies, and caffeine at the same time. And many of the caffeine products are not really high, maybe about 50 to 100 milligrams, but enough to give you a boost throughout the day. So I tend to use them not every day, but most days I tend to use them and I feel the benefits from them.
Terrific.
So, but we're developing them specifically for military type applications, for Angelman syndrome is a clinical trial that's ongoing right now. Kabuki syndrome, which is a rare genetic disorder, and the ketone body, beta-hydroxybutyrate, has been shown to influence gene expression or methylation, and that could be therapeutic for this particular disorder. So we view ketones not only as an energy substrate. Your brain can use glucose, or in a state of fasting or carbohydrate restriction, can use ketone bodies. So your brain's like a hybrid engine, so you're giving it an alternative fuel that can further enhance brain energy metabolism. So the science is pretty strong on that, and we're sort of capitalizing or exploiting the benefits of ketones into a supplement form.
This is something else that can be used for, it affects, you know, diet affects the way the pathways are for cancer. So
yes.
There's also some studies about using this type of eating plan for someone that has cancer. Can you talk about what the
Absolutely.
Research shows
yeah.
in that as well? It's not just for epilepsy or someone that's trying to lose weight. It has
yeah.
other scientific ways that it's being
so
used.
So that's a very hot area of research right now. We started looking at this about 8 years ago, and the ketogenic diet lowers blood glucose, you know, especially if it's calorie restricted. It elevates ketone bodies, and that therapeutic state reduces the growth and proliferation of most types of cancer cells. Probably more important is that it suppresses the hormone insulin, and insulin and various pathways like IGF-1 or I won't go down the weeds, but various pathways associated with high insulin are drivers for cancer growth and proliferation. So there's a big interest, not only in our lab, but nationally. There's 31 clinical trials right now. When I get into this, I don't think there was any registered clinical trials. So 31 clinical trials right now for using the ketogenic diet as a therapy for all different types of cancer, including endometrial cancer, ovarian cancer, a lot of brain cancer research right now, where they're using the ketogenic diet as an adjuvant to the standard of care, or if the standard of care for cancer has failed. And I know the New York Times, a big article came out last week, you guys might have saw it, Cornell and Columbia and Memorial Sloan Kettering are doing a very big trial on the PI3 kinase inhibitors, because that particular class of drug, I think it's one of the most promising drugs out there, only tends to work when it's combined with a ketogenic diet. So we have a scenario here where the diet is essentially priming the body or making the ideal environment for various drugs to work. That could be chemotherapy, radiation, or new classes of cutting-edge drugs like PI3 kinase inhibitors. So I think that's a very exciting area of research that's just starting to gain traction.
And the drug kind of helps clear the way for
yeah.
that one. Yeah.
The drug, it's a new class of drugs, and it tends to have the side effect, if you will, of elevating insulin, which could have negative effects. It could negate many of the effects of the drug. So the ketogenic diet, as I mentioned, suppresses the hormone insulin and insulin signaling, and really enhances the true efficacy of these PI3 kinase inhibitors. So that's the sort of the story in a nutshell, you know. And I think there's a number, I think 12 different cancer lines have been looked at already, so it may not be just brain cancer or endometrial cancer. It looks like the majority of cancers that are out there that have been studied so far are very responsive to this combination of the ketogenic diet and drug therapy, in this case PI3 kinase inhibitors that were developed by Dr. Luke Cameron.
Wow. You're so passionate about this subject. I think MCOM's really lucky to have you. So tell us about something that you're researching. You've traveled the world doing research on this. Talk about something that's going on here in this lab today.
Yeah, so right next door as you walked in, one of my students was, or a student of the lab here, was doing recordings on brain tissue, a specific area of the brain that releases reactive oxygen species in response to high oxygen. And we know Navy SEAL divers use closed circuit rebreathers, and the levels of oxygen get very high in their brain. So to protect them from that and protect them from seizures that could occur as a consequence of that, being in a state of nutritional ketosis makes diving, special operations type diving, much more safe and efficacious by essentially preventing a seizure from potentially occurring. So we develop things that can help the military with the safety and the performance of their mission. And a lot of what we do for the next 3 years, I will be studying different types of ketone supplementation and how they may be translated to human trials. So we have some trials going on right now at Duke University that's funded by NAVC, and the research in our lab and the equipment that you see behind us is funded by the Department of Defense and also the Office of Navy Research, and they have been funding us for 12 years now to develop and test countermeasures that could enhance the warfighter's ability under extreme environments. So that's really the cornerstone of what I do, and a lot of other projects kind of branch off of observations we make with the military-funded projects.
Terrific. Well, you've taken up a lot of your time today, but we really appreciate everything. Tell us the website that we can go to one more time.
Yeah, ketonutrition.org. And on there, you'll find a list of various interviews and talks that I gave, but more importantly, a lot of resources in regard to registered dietitians, doctors, ketogenic supplements, ketogenic foods, and a number of things that I think will help guide you and be a resource for implementing the ketogenic diet or just learning more about it.
Terrific. Thanks for your time. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for
having me. Thank you for joining us.